Good morning. Welcome to New Beginnings live stream. Hey, we are glad that you have decided to join us this morning as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Messiah, Jesus the Christ. And in just a minute, we are going to be led in worship by the Reader's Digest version, I guess you could say, of the worship team. But they sound fantastic. But first, I'd like to open up our time in prayer. All right. Well, Heavenly Father, just thank you for giving us this day today that we can come together in this way to be able to celebrate our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. And we just pray that you would just fill our homes with the presence, with the power of your Holy Spirit. And as we sing together and pray together, just prepare our hearts for what you would have us to learn through your word today. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
The love of God. place without hope and no place to begin. Your love wait away to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty. distractions eclipsed by glory. And I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh,
once again, good morning and glad you're here. And in the early days of the church, when the disciples of Christ would see one another, they would say, "He is risen." And then the other person would say, "He is risen indeed." And my understanding is that they would do that three times, and then it would get louder and louder. "He is risen. He's risen indeed. He's risen. He's risen indeed. Yes. All right." Because, see, it's all about the resurrection. See, if we didn't have the resurrection, we wouldn't have eternal life in this way. Have you ever played the game telephone? I would think most of us, if not all of us, have, to where someone starts by saying something and they whisper it in someone's ear, then they turn around and whisper it in someone else's ear, and so then you go to the end of the line and you see if the message was accurate, was consistent all the way throughout. A lot of times, usually for fun, what started out is totally different than what's at the end. So sometimes we have a little issue anyway in life with communication, right? We have the text messages, and many times people are quick to go to thinking, well, this person is saying it in this tone, instead of thinking, well, this person's being nice, that, well, they're being, you know, whatever. So anyway, in the area of communication, what I like to do is, and I've shown this several times before at church, but it's one of my favorite clips, and it deals with Andy Griffith and his son Opie. And there's a charity that's going on for the kids, for needy children. And Opie only gives a few cents instead of giving more. And so Andy is embarrassed with what Opie gave or what he didn't give. And so anyway, we're going to check out that video now.
Well, if it ain't Charlie Moneybags, the big philanthropist. How do you do?
What you talking about, Paul?
I'm talking about the underprivileged children's drive.
Oh, they collected for that at school, Paul.
Oh, I know they did. Oh, I know they did. And when they called your name, you gave the large, generous amount of 3 cents. My, that is big of you, Diamond Jim.
Did I give him too much, Paul?
Too much?
I could ask him to give back 2 cents.
Now, look here. We better talk about this thing. Now, look here, Opie. You can't give a little bitty piddling amount like 3 cents to a worthy cause like the underprivileged children's drive. I was reading here just the other day where there's somewhere like 400 needy boys in this county alone, or 1.5 boys per square mile.
There is?
There sure is.
I never seen one, Paul.
Never seen one what?
A half a boy.
Well, it's not really a half a boy. It's a ratio.
Horatio who?
Not Horatio, a ratio. It's mathematics. Arithmetic. Look, now, Opie, just forget that part of it. Forget the part about the half a boy.
It's pretty hard to forget a thing like that, Paul.
Well, try.
Poor Horatio.
Now, look, Horatio is not the only needy boy. Son, didn't you ever give anybody anything just for the pleasure of it? Something you didn't want anything in return for?
Sure, just yesterday I gave my friend Jimmy something.
Now, that's fine. What'd you give him?
A sock in the head.
I meant charity.
I didn't charge him nothing.
I meant something for the joy of giving.
I enjoyed it. I don't like Jimmy no more. He makes fun of Charlotte.
Who's Charlotte?
My girlfriend.
Well, I just don't see how anybody who has got as much as you could care so little about others.
I care about others honest.
Not when you give a little piddling amount like 3 cents. That's being selfish. You should have given at least a half a dollar or a dollar.
A dollar? Gosh, Paul, I only have $2.20 in my whole picky bank, and I'm saving it to buy Charlotte something.
Well, now, that's dandy. That is just dandy. Whole dollars you'll squander on your girlfriend, Charlotte, but when it comes to the underprivileged children's fund, you've got only 3 cents.
I wasn't gonna squander it, Paul. I wasn't gonna squander it.
Yeah.
What's squander?
That's throwing your money away foolishly.
Oh, but, Paul, I wouldn't be throwing it away.
All I can say is if your head can be turned by a pretty face at your age, heaven help you when you're grown up.
You see, if we miss the message of the resurrection, then we've missed it. See, Andy missed the message there. He didn't go to find out what Opie was doing with the rest of his money. What he was doing with the rest of his money is he had a little girlfriend, and he was saving money to buy her a jacket for the wintertime because she didn't have one. But Andy didn't ask him. He didn't seek out, why are you doing this? He just went and he assumed, which a lot of times when we assume, that can get us in some trouble, right? And sometimes we just assume that, okay, well, yeah, the resurrection, yeah, whatever. And there's some people that have not taken the time to check it out, and they just assume that it's not true. But you know what? It is true. And as we've been taking a look at the scriptures, the last 3 to 4 weeks, taking a look at the different prophecies that, whether they talked about Jesus or other things that were going to happen in the world, this Bible, we just continue to see it is one remarkable book. This morning, we're not going to take a look so much at the prophecies. We'll take a look at a few at the end. But what I want us to take a look at is the incredible power, just the incredibleness, that's a word. I went to Rio Grande High School, so I think it's a word. I don't know. But anyway, just the incredibleness of the resurrection. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 15, and the verses should be appear on your screen. 1 Corinthians 15, he says, I passed on to you what was most important and what had also been passed on to me. Again, what was what? Most important. He said, Christ died for our sins, just as the scriptures had said. The scriptures in the Old Testament, throughout the Old Testament. He goes on to say he was buried and he was raised from the dead on the third day, just as the scriptures said. He was seen by Peter, then by the 12. After that, he was seen by more than 500 of his followers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he was seen by James, and later by all of the apostles. But tell me this, since we preach that Christ rose from the dead, why are some of you saying there will be no resurrection of the dead? You know, what's up? What's happening? For if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless. And you're still guilty of your sins. In that case, all who have died believing in Christ are lost. And if our hope in Christ is only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. He is the first of a great harvest of all who had died. So you see, just as death came into the world through a man, now the resurrection from the dead has begun through another man. And just as everyone dies because we all belong to Adam, everyone who belongs to Christ will be given new life. But there is an order to this resurrection, that Christ was raised as the first of the harvest, then all who belong to Christ will be raised when he comes back. You know, if it's not true, why bother with another dead religion? We have plenty of dead religions. You know, every religious leader that has ever been born on the face of this earth, except for Jesus, has died. Well, Jesus did die, but he came back to life. Nobody has ever done that. See, the Apostle Paul knew that the power of God to live, the power of God to forgive, the power of God to restore, to bring emotional and physical healing, all of that is illustrated in the resurrection. And the Apostle Paul not only said it's essential, but he said in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, he said, I want to know Christ and experience what? The mighty power. That's the word dynamis, where we get the word dynamite. Dynamite! The mighty power that raised him from the dead. I want to experience that. I know I want to do that too. And the only way that I can experience that is when I push Mark off to the side and I say, Jesus, you are on the throne of my life. I need to follow you and what your incredible word, the Bible, tells me how you want me to live, that you want me to love one another, you want me to be patient with one another, you want me to encourage one another, you want me to forgive one another, and on the list goes. And we can't do that apart from Jesus. See, the resurrection illustrated the greatest power ever unleashed on planet Earth. Think about it. How much power does it take to infuse a lifeless corpse with life and vitality? More than anybody has ever seen demonstrated. Paul says this in Ephesians 1:18. He says, I'm praying that your hearts will be flooded with light so that you can see, so you can understand the confident hope. Not that we have to shrink back, but the confident hope he has given to those he called, his holy people who are his rich and glorious inheritance. I also pray that you will understand, that you'll see it, you'll understand it, the greatness of God's power for us who believe him. Now, that word believe in our culture, basically it's more of an intellectual thing. Yeah, okay, well, I believe it. But in the culture of the day in the Middle East, that when one believed, it was more than just an intellectual thing. It was placing your faith and one's trust. It was an action word into whatever you were believing. And so it would be, for example, you would say, yeah, I'm thirsty, so I believe I'm going to take a drink. Okay? Where I would say, if I was in the Middle East, I would say, yes, I believe that I'm going to take a drink, and I would do it. Because, again, believe is an action word. It's about faith and trust. Not just some intellectual, yeah, okay, I believe. He said, I pray that you will understand the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe him. This is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead and seated him in the place of honor at God's right hand in the heavenly realms. Paul wanted us to know the power that is associated with the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the prayer that he had in his heart of hearts for his people, that I have for mine, for me, my family, and my church family, my friends, and beyond, is that we would all know it, understand it, and then know it by personal experience, that we believe in him. And so because of our belief in our relationship with Jesus, then we get to experience the power to be people who can love the unlovable, can be patient with those that we don't want to be patient with, to be kind and all of that. Philippians 3, verses 8 to 10, Paul writes this. He says, yes, everything else is worthless compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have discarded everything else, counting it all as garbage, so that I could gain Christ and become one with him. I no longer count on my own righteousness through obeying the law. Rather, I become righteous, because there are a lot of people that were doing that. So I'm obeying the law, so I'm okay. And people still do that today. As long as I go to church and I pray and I follow the Ten Commandments, then I'm okay. Well, that's great, and that's a part of it. But that's not salvation. Salvation is putting faith in Jesus. And then as we get to know him better through prayer, through his word, and experience his presence through prayer, his word, and through Christian brothers and sisters, then that relationship grows. So it's about having a relationship. And back then, just like today, there are some people that, no, it's about obeying the rules. Well, no, it's not. It's about having faith in Jesus. And then, going by how he would have us to live. Sure. He says, I become righteous through what? Faith in Christ. For God's way of making us right with himself, it depends on faith, as I've been talking about. I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised him from the dead. I want to suffer with him, sharing in his death. Okay. So the resurrection power, the same power that brought life to a coldless, lifeless body, that same power begins in our life by knowing him. And that word to know means to know by experience. And that word to know was a word that was used when a husband and wife would come together in intimacy, and that they would know one another in that way. And so that's that word. We can say that we know, you could say, yeah, I know LeBron James. Well, I do. I know LeBron James, but he doesn't know me. I don't have his personal phone number. I can't call him up and say, hey, LeBron, what's happening, bro? I can't do that. But see, with Jesus, he says, no, I want to have a personal relationship with you, so that you know me. And in that we are one. We become one. Okay. As a human being, we'll never be good enough to meet God's standard of a holy lifestyle. That's why we need Jesus, because he comes in, he forgives us, and he takes our trash away, our sins away, and he infuses us with life, with resurrection power. So he wanted us to know a few things. So number one on the screen there is he wanted us to know that it begins with knowing God. Living a life of victory, it begins with knowing God, as we've been talking about. All right, so Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 to 8. The next thing Paul wants us to know. He says, I once thought these things were valuable, but now I consider them worthless or rubbish because of what Christ has done. Yes, everything else is worthless, is rubbish, when compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus personally, my Lord. For his sake, I have discarded everything else, counting it all as garbage, as rubbish, as worthless, so that I could what? I could gain Christ. My relationship with him can grow further and further and further. So the next thing he wants us to know about the resurrection is it dwarfs human accomplishment. It dwarfs human accomplishment. There's nothing that we could ever do to have God make us love him more or we can make God love us more or love us less. God loves us. And don't believe the lie that he doesn't, because he does. Because the enemy wants us to think, oh, but remember when you did this and you've done this and, you know, and you were with these people and you, okay, yeah, well, maybe that happened. In sin, as a Christian, as a disciple of Jesus, we are forgiven. And that's the truth. The lie is, no, we're not. The truth is, he wants to have a relationship with us no matter what. And that's awesome. And I can't, there's nothing I can do again to earn his salvation. So, the word rubbish here is an interesting word. It was a word that was used to describe food that was rotten. It was a word that was used to describe a rotten, decaying corpse. And it was also a word that was used to describe manure. And so it's nice that they translated it rubbish in a different way for a Sunday morning. Paul said, my greatest accomplishments in life are really a pile of manure compared to knowing Christ. And the people who don't understand that are the people who don't know him yet. Because as soon as you get to know him, again, he infuses our life with the power to become the person that he would have us to be, which is not only what's best for us, but it's best for everybody else. Okay, Mark 8:36 says, Jesus says, what good is it for a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? Great advice. Exactly. What good is it for a person to gain the whole world? Yeah, I've got all these accomplishments and I've done this and I've done that, but yet forfeit their soul, yet they end up in hell. All right, so it begins with knowing God. It dwarfs every human accomplishment. And then the resurrection power. The third thing it says here is that it can set us free. Can set you free from the past. It can set you free from the past. Philippians chapter 3 says, I don't mean to say that I've already achieved these things or that I've already reached perfection, but I press on to possess that perfection for which Christ Jesus first possessed me. No, dear brothers and sisters, I have not achieved it, but I focus on this one thing. Forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead, I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling us. So the resurrection power begins with knowing God. It dwarfs every human accomplishment, and the resurrection power can set us free from the past and free from the pain of the past. Sometimes that takes a while. And sometimes there's still going to be the feeling associated of things that have happened in the past that we've done or have been done to us. But over time, God wants to help us with that and have that be less and less and less. We know there's pain everywhere. Things that we've been through, there's pain, and sometimes that pain can cripple us. Paul said that the resurrection power, that power of Christ can set us free from the pain of the past. The next thing, next point to make is, while all healing doesn't involve forgiveness, all forgiveness involves healing. While all healing doesn't involve forgiveness, I don't feel good. I've got the flu. God, please touch me and heal me. Well, it might not have anything to do with forgiveness. But all forgiveness involves healing. And the question for us to ask today is, what's crippling us? Is it a painful childhood, an abusive mother or father, or a school teacher who broke our heart, or somebody else that broke our heart? I don't know what it is, but I do tell you this, that the power of the resurrection can set you free from the crippling effects of whatever happened. And no wonder Paul said, everything else is rubbish, it's garbage, it's worthless, it's trash, compared to this, to free us from the pain of the past and the poison of the past and the failures of the past. Because we all have failures, right? We've all been less than perfect, haven't we? When Jesus Christ went to the cross, his last words were, "It is finished." And what did he mean? Well, a couple of meanings. In the Jewish culture, it meant that the priest killed the lamb at that time. Okay, so to take a little trail here, Passover, Jesus died. He was considered the Passover lamb. That in the time of Moses, when they had the first Passover meal, God said, I want you to kill a lamb. It's got to be a perfect lamb. And I want you to put the blood of that lamb on the doorposts of your home. And for those that had the blood of the lamb on the doorposts of their home, that death came and death passed over that home, so there was life. All right? And so then, as they have celebrated Passover throughout the centuries, at 9 o'clock in the morning, the priest would put the Passover lamb on the altar. At 9 o'clock in the morning, Jesus was put on the cross. At 3 o'clock in the afternoon, the priest would say, "It is finished," and he would kill that lamb. At 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Jesus said, "It is finished," and he died. Something else. In Psalm 22 is known as the Messiah Psalm because there are so many prophecies about what is going to take place, specific prophecies that is going to take place, which when it was written 1,000 years into the future. So it was written 1,000 years before Jesus came. So the first verse, it says, my God, why have you forsaken me? In the last verse, it says of Psalm 22, because they didn't have verses back then. It was just on the scroll. And so then Jesus said, it is finished. So what he was doing was referred to as a remez, to where when the rabbi, before he would take a student under his wing to become his understudy, that he would test him by saying different scriptures. And so he might say, for God so loved. And, you know, we'd think, okay, for God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. And so then he might say, for God so loved, everlasting life. And then the person who wanted to be the understudy, be a student of the rabbi, he would need to recite the rest of the verse and talk about, well, this is what the topic was. So what Jesus was doing from the cross was he was doing a remez, that he said, it is finished. Well, excuse me. He said, my God, why have you forsaken me? And then it is finished. And so the people there, they would be thinking of all the other sentences in between. And what Jesus is saying is, I have fulfilled these scriptures. Now, I was always taught that at that time, God turned his face from Jesus, because that's why Jesus said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Because he couldn't look upon sin. And so I always thought, if he can't look upon sin, then how could he look upon his creation? That doesn't make sense. My mentor, Dr. Bean, he was an expert in the Dead Sea Scrolls, was on the Dead Sea Scrolls board, and was affiliated with Jerusalem School, Hebrew University. And so there are a number of scholars and archaeologists that would get together every so often, Christian and Jewish, and they would talk about the recent findings, and they would talk about the scriptures. And so one time one of the professors, okay, I'm going to believe I'm taking water right now. As they were talking about this passage, one of the professors said, you Christians, you don't know about your Jesus. He was Jewish. This is what he was doing. He wasn't saying this. He was saying that. And what he was saying was, again, look back to these scriptures. If you were to take a look at Isaiah 53, read through that. So Psalm 22, Isaiah 53, to check out the different prophecies that are there that Jesus has fulfilled. It's incredible. Okay, so it is finished. That's what the priest would say at 3:00, and then he would kill the Passover lamb, and that's what Jesus said, was it is finished, and then he died. In the Roman culture of the day, it meant that when a person was sentenced for a crime by the Roman government, they were given a scroll. On that scroll was listed the list of their crimes. So wherever they went, that scroll went with them, and it was nailed to the door of their cell so that every single day that they were in prison, they could see why they were there. Maybe not such bad advice for today's prisons. I don't know. Anyway, and so once they had completed the payment for their crimes against the state, that scroll was rolled up. And across the outside was a seal, and that seal said three words, it is finished. And it meant that they had been paid for, that you could never be tried for those again. So Jesus took our certificate of debt, which is what it was called. He nailed it to the cross, and his final words were, it is finished. The Jews and the Romans knew exactly what he meant. See, he will set us free from the failures of the past. It doesn't matter where we've been, what we've done. There is great hope. And why? It's because of the resurrection. The resurrection. In the Old Testament, and I mentioned this last Sunday, how things pointed to the new and to the cross, that the Passover, the blood of the lamb on the doorpost, that made the sign of a cross. And as I mentioned last week, and Bill and I talked about this last Wednesday night as well on our radio show, as we were taping it for today, that when the tribes, when the people, the Israelites left Egypt and they were camping in the desert, the smaller tribes were up here, the larger tribes were down here, and the medium tribes were here, and that made the sign of a cross. And then when they made the tabernacle and then the temple, the way they had the furniture was some furniture here, in there, and here, and here, and so it made the sign of the cross. Now, the word for Torah, and that'll come up on your screen here. Torah in the Hebrew is spelled T-V-R-H, because in Hebrew they have no vowels, okay? And each letter in Hebrew has meanings. It usually has like two or three different meanings. So the letter Tav means cross or covenant. The letter Vav means nail, means also to secure. The letter Resh means the highest person, and the letter Hey means to reveal. So the name for Torah, which could be the first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, and they could also refer, it can also refer to the whole Old Testament. It meant this when you put them together. Okay, so the word Torah means the covenant secured by the highest person revealed, or if you have it backwards, it's revealing the highest person nailed to the cross. So again, looking towards the cross. And then the word for God, Yahweh, as we say Yahweh. And the Yud means hand, the He means revealed, the Vav means nail, and the He means revealed. So when you put that together, it means this. The hand revealed, nail revealed. And where do we see the hand revealed, the nail revealed? We see that in Jesus. Again, it always focused towards Jesus and what he was going to do for us, for me, and for you. God gave his one and only Son. So whoever believes will have eternal life. I'm going to close with the video, and then I'm going to come back and pray. And the video, this is based on a true story. John Griffith had lost all he had in the stock market crash. He moved to Mississippi, where he took a job as a bridge operator for a railroad company. In 1937, he was involved in a horrible accident. One day, his 8-year-old son, Greg, spent the day with his dad at work. The boy was fishing next to the office as his dad could both work and keep an eye on his son. The bridge was over a river, and whenever a ship came, John had to open the bridge to allow the ships to pass. The day the boy was there with his father, well, a ship was coming, so John opened up the drawbridge. All right, so at this time, we're going to see that video now. don't know about you, pretty heavy, heavy-duty video to watch. The father gave his son's life so all of those people on the train could live. Otherwise, the train would have crashed and fallen into the river, and most, if not all of them, would have died. And you see just people sitting on the train, just going on with life as if nothing's happened because they don't know. Well, we know, and we know something happened. Jesus came so that we may have eternal life, so that we may live. I thought it was neat there. You see the picture of this one gal, she's doing drugs, and then later on you see her a few years later, and she has a child. And she has been healed of the drugs and has moved beyond that. You can do that. We can move whatever away from whatever is dragging us down. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for what you showed us today, what you taught us today. And God, there's so many different things we could talk about on this Resurrection Sunday. But Lord, I felt led that you led me into go this direction through what Paul talked about and the incredible change that you did in his life from going to a Jesus hater, a Christian hater, and dragging him out and having him killed, to leading people to you. And for all that he suffered because he claimed to be a disciple of yours. But he was able to go through it all because of the resurrection power that he experienced by having a personal relationship with you. So God, I just want to pray now that if there's anybody that is watching that they have never, or they've moved you off to the side, that they would commit for the first time or make a recommitment that, God, please forgive me for my sins. Thank you for your forgiveness. I want to accept Jesus Christ, or I want to put Jesus back on the throne of my life. I want to accept him as my Lord and Savior. Thank you for the love that you have for me. And God, please fill me with your Holy Spirit. And God, remind me to request that every day throughout the day so I could become the person that you would have me to be. And that your fruit, as you tell us in your word, the fruit of love and joy and peace and patience, not only would we feel that, but we would bring that into relationships. We would bring in love and joy and peace and patience and kindness, goodness and gentleness and faithfulness and self-control. That fruit, your fruit, would grow in our lives. And I thank you for that. Thank you for saving me today. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. You know, if you prayed that prayer, I would love to hear about it. You know, private message me on Facebook or email me, mark@nbccn.org. That's mark@nbccn.org. Go to our website, and there's a place on there you can leave a message as well. And the website is nbccn.org. That's nbccn.org. Well, he is risen, and he is risen indeed. And because of that, like the song says, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, my sins are gone. Thank you for that, Lord. And so, once again, thank you for tuning in today. May you have a great Resurrection Sunday. And hopefully, at some point in time, in the very near future, we'll all be able to come together physically and worship together in that way. So I just want to close with this blessing upon you, that may the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious on you. May the Lord show you his favor, and may he give you his peace. Amen. God bless you.
One, two, three.
Happy Easter.
Hey, we hope that you have a great Resurrection Sunday. From our family to yours, may you have a great day and an awesome year.
We love you. We miss you.
We would like to wish everybody a happy Easter from Jim and Lorraine Calvert. And we miss all of you.
Hi, everybody. Happy Easter from the Browns.
Happy Easter. Ho, ho, ho.
Happy Easter. Happy
Easter.
Easter from our Mendes family to yours.
Easter!
Everybody, it's Easter Sunday, and for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. We believe that, and we hope you do too.
Happy Easter.
From the Archambos.
Hello. We sure do miss you guys. Miss being there on Sundays and hugging everyone and talking with everyone. But we've really been enjoying the worship and Mark's sermons on Sunday on Facebook. So thank you for doing that and continue doing that so we can connect through there.
Yeah, love you guys and miss you guys. Hope to be back soon. It's good to see the online stuff. Getting kind of stir crazy here in the house, but hopefully we'll all be back together soon.
Love you guys.
Love you guys.
Risen.
He is risen indeed.
Happy Easter.
Hey, wait, who are those people over there? Social distance, come back! Happy Easter! From the people who came back from Asia!